Hello friend, this is part 10th of microservice tutorial. In first part, we discussed about monolithic and microservice architecture in detail. In second part, we created a Spring Boot application from scratch. In third part, we created our first microservice student using Spring Boot and MySQL. In fourth part, we created course microservice using Spring Boot and MS SQL. In fifth part, we discussed about API Gateway using Spring Cloud Gateway. In sixth part, we discussed about Eureka Server and working of Eureka Server. Seventh part, we seen how we can implement Eureka Server and client. In ninth part, we seen how a microservice can call another microservice using application name, and here we use web client. In eighth part, we seen how one microservice can call to another microservice using application name, and here we use REST template. In this video, we are going to understand what is circuit breaker and use of circuit breaker. We will use Resilience 4j. Before moving forward, I would like to request you to please like and share this video and subscribe the channel. Nowadays, we build all applications using microservice architecture. So what problem can we face if a microservice fails? Let's see all these aspects and how circuit breaker implementation can solve those problems. So in our case, we have a microservice student and another microservice course. So we want student details, including course details for that particular student through our API. So for that, student service needs to talk to course microservice. If we are using Spring Boot, the student service has a servlet thread pool, and for each incoming request, a thread will be assigned from the thread pool to serve the request. The thread will do request processing, and once the response is sent back to the user, the thread will be freed. So with this approach, we might face two kinds of failures. First is immediate failure. Let's say a student service gets a request and make a call to the course service. Whenever it tries to make a call to course service, it immediately sends an exception, connection refuse. This happens if a course service itself is down. In this case, we can wrap up our call to course service in a try catch block, and whenever we have an IO exception, we will just send a default response back to the user. The thread which was assigned to this call will be freed immediately as we got an exception. But the problem here is, if the course microservice is down and even if we make 10 calls, it still throws the same exception, then why we should send a request the 11th time? It's a high probability that the service might throw the same exception. So we have the overhead of making these repetitive failures calls. And second kind of failure is timeout failure. So in this case, if the student service makes a call to the core service and instead of an exception, it takes a long time to send the response back. We have assigned a thread, and this thread is waiting to get a response from the core service. In the meantime, we get more requests and we assign more threads to handle the requests and wait to get a response back from the core service. If the rate of request to a student service is very high, then at some point all threads from the thread pool are assigned and waiting for a response from core service. So we can reach to a point where a student microservice itself cannot take any request from user because all threads are busy in the previous request. So in this case, if we have a lot of services in our application, then a problem in one service can cause problem in a lot of other services. This is where the circuit breaker comes into play. So how does circuit breaker operate? The circuit breaker acts as a request interceptor, and let's say we add it to the student service. So whenever the student service calls other service like core service, all the requests should go through the circuit breaker. So whenever continuous exceptions are thrown from a particular service, then circuit breakers will stop subsequent requests. The circuit breaker doesn't stop the calls due to just one failure. As we know, intermittent failures are common, but it will stop the calls when exceptions or errors are constant for multiple calls in a short duration of time. The circuit breaker keeps track of how many calls succeeded and how many failed to a particular service. So let's say if 3 calls out of 5 calls is failing or taking more time to get response, then circuit breakers opens at that time so that the 6th call should not happen to the course microservice. There are 3 states of any circuit breaker. First is closed, second is open, and third is half open. So the first state is closed, which means the microservice is allowed to call the dependent microservice. The second state is called open, which occurs when the failure rate of request is above a particular threshold and the circuit breaker does not allow calls to dependent microservice. So for example, if 3 out of 5 calls is getting failed or delayed, then the circuit breaker state will become open. The third state is called half open. So once the status changes to open, the timer kicks in, and when the timeout expires, the state changes to half open and allows calls partially. That is, it allows few calls to the failed service and checks if the service has recovered. If these partial calls fails again, then the status changes back to open. But if they are success, then the status changes to closed and it starts allowing all the requests again. There are two types of circuit breaker pattern. First is count based and second one is time based. So in count based, we consider last n number of requests which is failing or getting timed out. So for example, if 50% of the last 20 requests took more than 2 seconds, then we consider this as a count based circuit breaker pattern. In time based pattern, we considered failing request or getting timed out in last n time unit. For example, if 50% of the last 60 seconds of request took more than 2 seconds, then it will be considered as a time based circuit breaker pattern. Let's see all these implementation and configuration in our code. This is our project setup. This is Spring Boot application is first microservice student, and this course is second microservice. Here we were using Eureka server for the registry and discovery, and this is gateway where we use Spring Cloud Gateway. Okay, so from this project student microservice, we were calling this particular API get by ID. And when you call this one, so internally we are calling a course API from here, from this API call. So here we are making one HTTP call to get the course detail by providing course ID, which is coming from the student details. This service, this particular service course slash ID is existing here in our course microservice. If you come here in course controller, here it is. Okay, so whenever we are calling from a student controller, sometimes this course microservice could not be running, or maybe the response is getting delayed to reach to the student microservice. So to resolve this, we are going to use Resilience 4j circuit breaker. So to use this one, what we have to do, first of all, we have to add the POM dependency for the Resilience 4j. So for that reason, I have added this Resilience 4j Spring Boot to POM dependency. And then in code, since we are making HTTP request call from this method, so we have to annotate this method with @ circuit breaker annotation. It is taking two value. First is name of the circuit breaker, and another one is the fallback method. Fallback method is useful whenever this particular course microservice is getting delayed or not sending the response or failing it, then this fallback method will be called. So we have to write the fallback method. Here I have written this one. So here I am saying that whenever the course microservice is failing, I am just creating a default course and returning the same. So if everything is fine with the course microservice, then we will get the data for that particular course ID. But if it is not working, or if it is failing or getting timed out based on our configuration, then we will get this particular default course details for each student. Now we have to configure application.properties files. So here we have application.yml. So here I have added all Resilience 4j properties which is required. So you see here Resilience 4j circuit breaker configs and shared. So from here we are keeping all the properties details. Here we have one property, sliding window type, count based. So we are using count based circuit breaker pattern. Here we have sliding window size 5. That means we are saying Resilience 4j to keep record of 5 requests. Out of 5 requests, we will decide that we have to open the circuit or close the circuit. Here it is failure rate threshold 40. 40 is percentage, in percentage. We are saying that 40% of this 5 requests, if it is failing or timed out, then we have to make circuit open. So 40% means 2. 2 out of 5 requests, if it is failing, then the circuit breaker will become open. That means we will not call coarse microservice again and again. Permitted number of calls in half open state 1. That means when the circuit breaker goes to half open state, so in that state, we will make one call to check coarse microservice is still down or is up. Max wait duration in half open state 10 seconds. So in half open state, we will wait for 10 seconds to make the another call. Wait duration in open state 10 seconds. Whenever the circuit breaker is in open state, we have to wait for 10 seconds to become it to half open state or to close state. Slow call duration threshold 2 seconds. This means if the response is taking more than 2 seconds, then we will consider this as a failure and it will become as a half open state or closed state. And this property is saying that we are using a shared base configuration. For detailed information about all this configuration, you can check the Resilience 4j documentation. Okay, so we have set up our circuit breaker. Now let's start all our application and let's check through Postman. So first of all, I will start Eureka server. And then I will start gateway service. After this, I will start Spring Boot application, which is student microservice. Here, I am not going to start coarse microservice because we want to see the circuit breaker fallback method if the coarse microservice is not working. Let's check the Eureka console. We'll type localhost 80838. And here you see we have gateway registered on the Eureka server and student service registered on the Eureka servers. But the coarse microservice is not running. So now let's go to Postman and we will try to hit the student microservice. So I'm going to get the details of ID 3. So here we have student details and the course details. This course data is coming the default one, course, common course. You see here in our code, here we have this fallback method. Since the coarse microservice is not running, so fallback method is being called and we are getting this default core common coarse details. If you see the logs also, in logs it is saying calling coarse microservice API using REST template and it is saying no server available for Spring coarse service, and here this is printing calling fallback and returning default coarse data. So this logger.info is being printed here. Okay, now let's start the coarse microservice as well. Okay, so coarse microservice is also running and purposefully I have delayed the response from the coarse microservice. Here you go coarse controller. So if you see the implementation of this method here, purposefully I have made the response to be delayed by 2 seconds. Thread.sleep 2000 in millisecond, which is equivalent to 2 seconds. So as per our configuration, here we seen slow call duration threshold 2 seconds. So if there is a 2 second delay in the response, we will consider this as a failure. But this 2 second delay should happen of 40% request out of 5 request. Okay. So let's check this one. Let's try first request. Okay. Hit first time, one time. It is waiting for 2 seconds. We got the response. You see course ID 1 and now this is coming from our database. Now let's hit the another second time. Again, it is waiting for 2 seconds. We got response. Again hit. And now see your third request is failing. So we already recorded 5 requests, total 5 requests. And out of 5 requests, 2 was failed. That's why the third request, it returned the default course data, which is common course. Okay, let's hit it again. It is again giving us the same default course details. That means in this case, our circuit breaker has gone to the open state. So in meanwhile, after waiting 10 seconds in the open state, again circuit breaker will try to call the coarse microservice whenever we hit the request again. Okay, and whenever it gets the response proper, then it will return you the exact response from the course microservice. Okay guys, we successfully understood the circuit breaker pattern. In next coming videos, we will see the cloud config for the global configuration and Spring Cloud Sleuth for the logging in microservices. If this video is useful for you, so please like and share the video and don't forget to subscribe the channel. Click on bell button to get notification for the upcoming videos. Thank you very much.